Venite, exultemus Domino, venite, adoremus.
Welcome, everyone. Good evening, and welcome to all of you. I can't tell you how excited and happy we are to see all of you, to see your smiling eyes. We're so happy that you're here. We want you to take home the light of Christ and the joy and the peace of this evening. Father Bill, I'm going to turn it over to you now.
Good afternoon. Merry Christmas. I have a lot to say. I think this is the first time I've met some of you, and it's the first time you've had a chance to meet me since I became pastor of Christ the Redeemer on July 1st. And I know that we've all been suffering through this time of the coronavirus pandemic with masks and social distancing and hand washing and all the difficulties that have come through it, but I want to thank you for coming to celebrate Christmas with us here today. I know that this church normally has 1,000 chairs, and this mass is normally overflowing with people standing on the walls and out in the gathering area. But in an effort to keep you safe and to protect the common good and follow the laws of the state of Michigan and of the Archdiocese of Detroit, we have to limit our seating to 250 people. But look how full it still looks. And so I'm glad that we are here together, and I'm glad that for the first time I can meet some of you. It has been an extraordinarily interesting almost 6 months as your pastor, trying to come into a new place, in a new area, in a new parish, with new people, doing different things, and trying to lead and guide. I hope some of you have watched my daily Facebook messages. Any of you see those? And we try to keep in touch with you by email regularly. We have the print edition of The Connection, and for those of you who are coming to Mass regularly, you know that even in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, we are doing our best to continue to worship, to serve, to educate, and to be good stewards of scarce resources. Today, as we gather to celebrate this first Mass of Christmas, let me share with you a traditional Christmas proclamation. Earlier this afternoon in Rome, which is 6 hours ahead of Detroit, this proclamation was made just as Pope Francis began celebrating the first Mass of Christmas at St. Peter's Basilica in Vatican City. Today, unknown ages from the time when God created the heavens and the earth, and then formed men and women in his own image, several thousand years after the flood, when God made the rainbow shine forth as a sign of the covenant. 21 centuries from the time of Abraham and Sarah, 13 centuries after Moses led the people of Israel out of Egypt, 1,100 years from the time of Ruth and the judges, 1,000 years from the anointing of David as king, in the 65th week, according to the prophecy of Daniel, in the 194th Olympiad, the 752nd year from the foundation of the city of Rome, the 42nd year of the reign of Octavian Augustus, the whole world being at peace. Jesus Christ, eternal God and Son of the eternal Father, desiring to sanctify the world by his most merciful coming, being conceived by the Holy Spirit, and 9 months having passed since his conception, was born in Bethlehem of Judea to the Virgin Mary. Today is the Nativity of our Lord Jesus Christ according to the flesh. Let us stand and join in our gathering song. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Brothers and sisters, as we gather on this holy night, celebrating the Nativity of our Lord Jesus Christ, together, let us give praise and glory to God.
Sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you
Brothers and sisters, let us pray. O God, you have made this sacred night radiant with the splendor of the true light. Grant that we who have known the mysteries of his light on earth may also delight in his gladness in heaven. For he lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. The prophet Isaiah lived approximately 750 years before Christ. In his time, the northern kingdom of Israel was laid waste by the armies of Assyria. Today's passage offers these conquered people hope for a glorious future. God will remember the covenant made with King David. And someday, a new king bringing peace will arise for the people.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwelt in the land of gloom, a light has shone. You have brought them abundant joy and great rejoicing. As they rejoice before you, as at the harvest, as people make merry when dividing spoils. For the yoke that burdened them, the pole on their shoulder, and the rod of their taskmaster, you have smashed as on the day of Midian. For every boot that tramped in battle, every cloak rolled in blood, will be burned as fuel for flames. For a child is born to us, a son is given us. Upon his shoulder, dominion rests. They name him Wonder Counselor, God Hero, Father Forever, Prince of Peace. His dominion is vast and forever peaceful. From David's throne and over his kingdom, which he confirms and sustains by judgment and justice, both now and forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
A proclamation of Psalm 98.
Letter to Titus, early Christians are reminded that the celebration of the incarnation of Jesus Christ is not a one-day event. Rather, the truth of Christmas lies in how we act every day.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to Titus. Beloved, the grace of God has appeared, saving all and training us to reject godless ways and worldly desires and to live temperately, justly, and devoutly in this age, as we await the blessed hope, the appearance of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to deliver us from all lawlessness, and to cleanse for himself a people as his own, eager to do what is good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment when Quirinius was the governor of Syria. So all went to be enrolled, each to his own town. And Joseph, too, went from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David that is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the family of King David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. While they were there, the time came for Mary to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them at the inn. Now there were shepherds in that region, living in the fields and keeping night watch over their flock. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with great fear. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Christ and Lord. And this will be the sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was a multitude of the heavenly hosts with the angel, praising God and singing, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom God's favor rests." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord
Jesus Christ.
Let me tell you about the Christmas of the year that I was 8 years old. My parents had had a financially difficult year. The washer and dryer both broke down. The refrigerator broke down. The car needed new tires. Catholic school tuition had increased. And so, consequently, on Christmas morning, I saw that Santa was cheap. There was far less under the tree than there had ever been before. And I, being an 8-year-old who was used to being a little spoiled at Christmas, complained. "Where is everything?" I said. My sister, too, had her own words of complaint. My mother sat silent, which was pretty unusual for my mom because she had something to say about everything. And my dad, who tended to be quiet and thoughtful, said, "Son, come here." And he pulled me onto the couch in our living room near the Christmas tree. He said, "Stay here. I'll be right back." He went to the kitchen. He opened the refrigerator. And though I could not see what he got something from the fridge. He came back into the living room carrying an orange. And he said, "Son," he always called me son, "son, let me tell you about the Christmas I received an orange. Only an orange." My dad grew up during the Great Depression, which lasted from 1929 to 1940. A lot of people were living in poverty. People were in bread lines and soup lines, losing jobs and businesses. Times were difficult for our nation and indeed for the entire world. And my dad said, one of those Christmases, in the midst of the Great Depression, I received an orange. And it was less than I was used to. But it was good. And it was fresh. And it was sweet. And then he said, when I complained to my parents, as you just did to me, that this Christmas seemed to be so much less than other Christmases, my parents reminded me that we still had food to eat. My parents reminded me that we still had our health. My parents reminded me that we still had each other, that we still had our faith, and therefore we had everything. And that anything else on top of that should be considered a bonus. And that therefore I should enjoy my orange. And I, with my 8-year-old eyes, looked at my dad and said, I can do that. I can enjoy the orange. My dad said, no, not this orange, but enjoy what Santa did bring. It might be less, but we have our health, and we have food, and we have our faith, and we have each other, and it's still Christmas. Isn't it, son? I said, it is. It's a Christmas. This Christmas of 2020 is unlike any other Christmas any of us have experienced. And many of us might be experiencing this Christmas as being a lot less than any other Christmas has ever been. Less gatherings, less parties, less festivities, less time together. We wear masks and can't see each other's faces. We have to maintain social distancing. We have to give air hugs to people we love. If you've been to the mall, whether Great Lakes Crossing or Oakland Mall or Partridge Creek or Somerset or some other mall, a lot less people shopping. I imagine tonight Santa's sleigh is a lot lighter than usual. Everything seems to be different. And we've experienced a great sense of loss ever since March, when this pandemic began. But maybe there's a lesson to be found today on this Christmas Eve, on this Christmas of 2020. The lesson found in an orange, but certainly the lesson also found in today's gospel. Jesus, our Savior, the one whom the angels declared was both Christ and Lord for all the people, was not born into glory, was not born into richness. He was born of a humble, working-class couple who lived in Nazareth up north and had to come down to Bethlehem in the south for the census, the enrollment that we heard about in today's gospel. There was no room for them at the inn. There was no Holiday Inn. There was no Ramada. There was no Sheraton. There was no Hilton. There were just people opening up their rooms, more like a bed and breakfast. But all of those were full. And here's this working class couple expecting their first child, and what do they have to do? Go into a barn and lay this child in a manger where the animals feed, and lay him on hay. Does this sound like a king? Does this sound like glory? Does this sound like greatness to you? Does this sound like more? Does it sound like the first Christmas was exultant, was exuberant, beyond the cry of those angels, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace? No. The first Christmas was simple. The first Christmas was humble. The first Christmas was empty. And that child, wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger, would 33 years later be wrapped once again in linen and laid in his tomb, and finally bring salvation to the world by his resurrection. But we don't know any of that on this day. All we know is a child is born to us and a son is given. That news is so great, yet so simple. Yes, our faces are covered with masks. And yes, as your new pastor, hi, I'm Father William Promesso. I became pastor here on July 1st. It's hard to get to meet all of you. And so much of the socializing and things we do during this time of year and throughout the year in parish life, we've not been able to do. I, with you, experience a great diminishment this Christmas and have been experiencing it all year. But just because we experience this Christmas as somehow being less, is it really less? Does it have to be less? Do we have to consider it less? Or rather, does a lesson of an orange and a baby laid in a manger in swaddling clothes in a little town of Bethlehem remind us that we still have each other? We still have our faith. We still have hope. We still have our church. We still have our families. We still have poinsettias. We still have candles. We still have carols. We still have trees. Maybe it's different than it's ever been before. And maybe we experiencing it, therefore, as somehow being less. But maybe sometimes the lesson is found in something as simple as an orange to a boy growing up in the Great Depression. That less might actually be more. Because it can force us to focus not on what we think we've lost, but on what we have and what we can still gain. After that Christmas when I was 8 years old, from that Christmas forward, my parents always had on our family Christmas tree an orange ornament. Until my father passed away, the one orange ornament was always on our family tree. A reminder to us every year of the simplicity of Christmas and the importance not of what we've lost, but of what we have. Our faith, our family, our health, food to eat, and hope for the days ahead. And so I thought, in the midst of this Christmas that seems so much less than so many others, that perhaps we too should start a tradition here at Christ the Redeemer to remind ourselves in years to come of this Christmas of 2020 that might seem like so little, but holds the promise like a child in a manger of so much more. Let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us bring all of our cares and concerns on this Christmas Eve before that child laid in a manger.
Glory to God in the highest. Let every voice be raised in praise and thanks to our God. We sing to you. Prince of Peace, may wars and violence end over all the earth. We sing to you. Radiant light, shine upon people who dwell in pain and darkness. Enlighten them on the path to comfort and joy. We sing to you.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria.
Son of righteousness, bring your reign of justice so that the oppressed may find freedom. The hungry be fed and the poor will be satisfied. We sing to you. Emmanuel, God with us, you were born into this world as one like us. May we regard all people with dignity and respect. We sing to you.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria.
Divine Savior, give your grace and healing to the sick, caregivers and healthcare workers. We sing to you. Word of the Father, awaken those who have died so that they may join with the angels in their Christmas song of joy. We sing to you.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria.
Mighty God, receive our personal needs and our attentions for John Jarvis, Henry and Eleanor Koloba, the deceased members of the Miller, Luby, and Edwards families, and all the people of Christ the Redeemer. We sing to you.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria.
Venite adoremus, venite adoremus, venite adoremus Dominum. Amen. If this is your first time back in church since March, You might be surprised that the preparation of the altar and the presentation of the gifts, like many things, does not happen the way it used to. And again, like much of this holiday, it feels like less. But throughout this pandemic, the people of Christ the Redeemer have continued to support our parish financially and prayerfully with their own efforts so that we might continue to offer our ministries of worship and education, of service and stewardship. And though the altar and the gifts are presented differently than they ever were before, we recognize not what we've lost, but what we have. Your support, your kindness, and your love. And we thank you with hearts filled with gratitude for your generosity that has enabled us to continue to be financially healthy and spiritually healthy, even through this time of the pandemic. If you brought a financial offering, but there is no basket to pass, there is a large basket at the baptismal font. You're welcome to drop something in on your way outside the doors. There are also boxes on the walls inside, just inside the doors of the church that can also receive your financial gift or your envelope. But keep in mind that though this time might seem like less, we pray that we might experience less as more, just as a child born in a manger reminds us of how much we still have. Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours might be made acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Lord, may the oblation of this day's feast be pleasing to you, that through this most holy exchange we may be found in the likeness of Christ, in whom our nature is united to yours. For he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, a new light of your glory has shone upon the eyes of our mind, so that as we recognize in him God made visible, we may be caught up through him of love of things we cannot see. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as with one voice we proclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun till its setting, a perfect sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when their supper was ended, he took a cup filled with wine, and once again, giving thanks and praise, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, Father, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you chose to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by his body and blood and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Joseph, her husband, with the apostles and martyrs, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. Lord, may this sacrifice of our reconciliation advance the peace and salvation of all the world. So be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Alan, our Bishop, with the order of bishops and all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this earthly life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. For there we too hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence to our Heavenly Father in the words our Savior Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin. Protect us from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Be careful, but offer each other a socially distant greeting of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord God, grant that we who are gladdened by our participation in this feast of the Redeemer's Nativity may, through an honorable way of life, become worthy of union with him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. We have some announcements for your listening pleasure. Christopher, what's going on?
So we do have a pair of car keys that was found out in the parking lot. It's got a Star Wars figurine on it. It's on a table over there by those doors. So
check your pockets.
Check those pockets.
What else?
So daily mass will not be offered on Tuesday or Friday this week. We will celebrate the Solemnity of Mary, Mother of God, on Thursday, New Year's Eve at 5 p.m. Come and worship as we say farewell to 2020.
And good riddance. Right?
Right.
Am I right? Yeah? Yeah. I'm hoping, Chris, that next Christmas we'll have 1,000 seats back here in church. Right? Right, amen. Right.
So monthly anointing of the sick will be offered on Friday, January 8th at 9 Mass. This sacrament is for those suffering in body, mind, or emotions, preparing for surgery, or living with a chronic, terminal, or temporary illness.
Amen. Thanks, Chris. I'm so excited that, Mary, you want to say something? No? Oh, you turn the microphone off. Yeah. This is my first Christmas here at Christ the Redeemer. And I'm so happy to be here with all of you, and I look forward to meeting you and seeing your whole face long before next Christmas. There are many ethnic backgrounds that make up our parish community, and so since many people celebrate their ethnicity as often as they celebrate Christmas and with Christmas, we extend to you these Christmas greetings in the many languages of Christ the Redeemer. In French, Joyeux Noël. German, Fröhliche Weihnachten. Japanese, Merry Christmas. Welsh, Nadolig Lavin. Italian, Buon Natale. Hindi, Shub Christmas. Mandarin Chinese, Shen Dong Kuala. Maltese, Il Miliud It Tayeb. Hawaiian, Meleke Nikimaka. Portuguese, Feliz Natal. Tagalog, Malagayeng Pasko. Albanian, Gazur Krishlindiut. Polish, Vesovich Fjunt. Czech, Vesele Venoce. Spanish, Feliz Navidad. Canadian, Merry Christmas, eh? Vietnamese, Zhang Sing Vuive. Greek, Kala Christoyena. And finally, Latin, Felicem Natalem Christi. No matter what language you say it, we wish you a Merry Christmas, blessed and holy travels and gatherings. I want to thank our music ministers for beautiful music. Thank you so much. And all those who have worked so tirelessly in the background, trying to plan out, planning for the worst and hoping for the best so that we could be here together to celebrate Christmas. May the Lord be with you. Bow your head and pray for God's blessing. Oh, may the Son of God enfold you with his Spirit and his love. May he ease your mind and satisfy your soul. Let him have the things that hold you, and his Spirit, like a dove, will descend upon your life and make you whole. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, go forward in faith, as we love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.